Someone once said to me, how could a kind God, how could a kind God that supposedly loves us only give 6 billion or more people on this planet only one way to have a relationship with him? How could that be kind? Listen, that's really not the right question. The question is, how could a God who is so holy look at people who are so unholy and give us any way to have a relationship with him? That's the question. That he gives us one way should cause us to celebrate for the rest of our lives. That he sent his beloved son so that you and I might be delivered from the person of Satan in our lives. Not only must we be delivered from that person, but we've got to be delivered from a place. In your workbooks, you've got a map that I want you to start looking at today. Because on that map, you're going to follow it for the entire 6 weeks. You're going to see how the journey from Egypt all the way to the promised land unfolds. And I want you to open that up right now and get a good look at that map, because you need to see the proximity of Egypt to the promised land. There was a great distance, a great gulf called the wilderness that we're going to travel to, a great gap called the wilderness. There was a great distance in between the two, and they had to traverse that land if they were going to make it from one place to the other. But in order for them to do that, they had to first not just be delivered from a person, they had to first be delivered from a place called Egypt. Get a good look at that place on the map and get it cemented in your mind. Because they could be freed legally from the person of Pharaoh till they were blue in the face. But until they packed their bags, put one foot in front of the other, and left Egypt, they would never be any closer to reaching their destination of the promised land. That would require them getting up from where they were, following their deliverer, Moses, out of, for lack of a better term, their cozy comfort zone. I call it their cozy comfort zone. Obviously, it wasn't fun for them. They were enslaved there. But you need to know that they spent many years of prosperity in Egypt before the slavery began. 400 years they'd spent there, and a large portion of it had been on friendly terms with Egypt because of Joseph, a son of Jacob, who had been sent there, who had risen in the ranks, Egyptian ranks, so that he was a ruler there. People looked up to him, and he was able to kind of be a mediator, a go-between between Egypt and Israel. So for a long time, they lived together in peace. And for 400 years, they had learned the ways of Egypt. They had begun to enjoy the foods of Egypt. They had gone to the institutions in Egypt, learned the philosophies of Egypt. This was their comfort zone. This is what they'd known for generations. And now God was saying to them, yeah, but if you want to come fully and completely with me on this journey, you've got to pack your bag, leave behind everything you have up to this point known to be true. And you've got to walk away from it and follow me. Being freed from Pharaoh, the person, wasn't enough. Now they had to get freed from the place. Listen, you need to know that it's surprising to me how many believers in Jesus Christ are indeed free from the person, but they're still living in the places where the enemy rules. They're still involved in those relationships. They still watch those movies. They still read those books. They still love that television series. They're still bound by that habit, that lifestyle, that sin, that immoral living that is keeping them from leaving the boundaries that are governed by Satan. You've got to make a hard call. Not only do you need to do some soul searching, or better yet, pray like the psalmist did in Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know me. Find out if there's any way within me that just isn't right, so that you can lead me on the path to everlasting life. David knew better. He said, you know what? I can't do good searching. If you'll take a magnifying glass out and search me, that'd be better, God. And so we all have to ask him to search me. Lord, find out if I need to be freed from the person. But all of us also need to ask a second question. Are we still hanging out in some of the places where the enemy reigns? Are there some habits, some lifestyle choices that we've made, and we're still living in those places and doing those things when we know that they are a hindrance to all that God wants to do in our life? Now, this is where the journey already gets tough. We haven't even left Egypt yet, and the journey's tough. Because it's hard to decide that this person in my life, it's not necessarily a sinful relationship, but Paul writes, rid yourself of every sin and hindrance. It might not be a sin, could just be a hindrance to what God is doing. Is there a friendship, a relationship where the girlfriends that you're hanging out with, I mean, they're good girls, but they're not trying to go all the way with God. I mean, they're good for hanging out and going to the movies with, but you know, God is stirring in you a desire for more in your relationship with Him. And these are the girlfriends that just don't think it takes all of that. Maybe there's a relationship, single woman, that you're in, and that guy is a nice guy. He dresses nice. He drives the right car. He's a Christian. He goes to church. But he's not trying to be serious about this God thing. He's just kind of a Christian in name only. See, this is when the decisions get hard, because it might mean for you cutting out some of the people in your life, cutting out some of the habits. I mean, your favorite television series, but you know some of the things that you're watching. It's very obvious to you that that is where the enemy rules. You've been in a movie before, haven't you? And you get to that place in the movie where that's being said or that is happening, and there's something in you that just says, now would be a good time for you to get up and walk out. The question is, when those times occur, will we stay seated in those places where the enemy reigns and rules? Or will we get up and follow God on this journey? It's a difficult decision that each and every one of us need to decide, whether or not we want to go where God is leading. Staying in Egypt, although free from the person of Pharaoh, wouldn't have gotten them any closer to the promised land. In order to get milk and honey, they had to walk away from the place where Pharaoh ruled. And if you're born in Egypt, if you've been fed in Egypt, if you've been reared in Egypt, schooled in Egypt, the only way to rid yourself of the taste of Egypt's food, the only way to do that, and the only way to rid yourself of the mindset instilled in you at Egypt's universities, is to relocate yourself to the place where Egypt's philosophies and desires are no longer taught and their food isn't even offered anymore. You got to decide, am I willing to go to that radical place? Don't for a second think that I am suggesting that this is going to be easy. It's going to mean making some difficult choices for you. It certainly has for me. I've had to decide, am I going to go on this journey with God or not? I called up a friend of mine who wanted to go on this journey with me. She decided that there were some things she was going to cut out of her life so that she could walk fully and confidently out of Egypt and go on this journey with God, risks and all. And she had to cut off some friendships in her life to do this. And I was calling to check on her one day because she was experiencing a little bit of loneliness. And I didn't get her, but I got her voicemail. Her voicemail said this: thank you for calling. I'm so glad you've called. Please leave a message. But I want you to know, I'm making some changes in my life. If I don't call you back, you are one of the changes. You just do what you gotta do. Do what you gotta do. An author by the name of Portia Nelson wrote something that I recorded in a book called A Jewel in His Crown many years ago, and it always comes back to my mind. Portia Nelson writes, chapter 1. I walk down the street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I'm lost. I'm helpless. It's not my fault, though. It takes a long time to get out. Chapter 2. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in. I can't believe I am in the same place, but it's not my fault. It takes a long time to get out. Chapter 3. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it there. I fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It's my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4. I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Chapter 5. I walk down a different street. You ever gotten to the place where it occurs to you, you just need to walk down a different street? You cannot do what you have always done and expect different results. You want to see more of God evident in your life. You want to start hearing His voice, experiencing His power. You want to start having a relationship with Him that goes beyond the pew to the pavement of your everyday living. Then we've got to walk down a different street. Galatians 5:1 tells us, my life verse, it is for freedom that you have been made free. Therefore, stand firm and don't be subject again to a yoke of slavery. I love the two parts of that verse. Listen to it. It is for freedom that you have been made free by Christ. That's His part. He's made you free. In fact, it didn't even cost you anything. He gave it to you on a silver platter. And now here's your part. Stand firm and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. walk with one foot in front of the other by the power of the Spirit of God within you, so that you and I can pack our bags once and for all and get out of the place where the enemy reigns.